Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Unfiltered, How to Be as Happy as You Look on Social Media by Jessica Abo. Narrated by Lisa Larsen. Foreword. Kelly Rutherford, mom, actress, activist, philanthropist. At Kelly Rutherford. As I write this foreword, I'm on a plane. I just packed up my New York City apartment and am thrilled to be spending time with my kids before I move and start filming a new show called The Perfectionists. The title of my new show and this book, Unfiltered, have one thing in common. They remind us of the overwhelming pressure so many people face to showcase a picture-perfect life. I know that burden all too well. As a kid, my family moved around a lot. I was often an outsider at school, observing different cliques, trying to figure out where I belonged. I spent my 20s figuring out who I was and how I was different from my parents. I also started the journey of accepting myself and my body. It's a journey I'm still on to this day. My 30s were really about work, love, and becoming a mother, the greatest gift of all. My 40s have shown me to be thankful for my health and well-being, and to be grateful for everything I have. As I approach 50, I can tell you I've loved, I've lost, I've learned, and I've grown. I've been blessed with a career many actors dream of, but I have to tell you, some days were hard. If you follow me on my social media, you know I don't shy away from posting on those hard days and try to use my platforms to lift up other people. I do it because you may be having a hashtag FML day while everyone else seems to be having a hashtag YOLO day. And I want you to know you're not alone. Life is a beautiful, imperfect mess, and that's okay. My only wish is that more people would embrace their real lives. That real life, the one beyond the filters we use on our pictures before we post them, that's the good stuff. Your life is your own authentic experience, and you should be proud of your story, no matter what everyone else is posting today. That's why I love this book and Jessica's message. I first met Jessica when she interviewed me in New York City for NY1 News about my handbag line. We ran into each other at New York Fashion Week, and then again on the set of Gossip Girl when she played a TV reporter on the show. I really got to know Jessica when she asked me to host a black tie event she was organizing for people who need a bone marrow transplant. As you will learn in this book, Jessica was so passionate about her Marrow Match Gala that she visited me while I was filming Gossip Girl so I could get swabbed and join the International Bone Marrow Registry. The Jessica I met many years ago is the same one you're about to meet here. She embraces life in all its messy, complicated glory because she tries to live her life in an authentic way. In this book, Jessica gets into the nitty-gritty of how you can get out of your rut. If you're frustrated with your career path or lack of community activism, she will help you find a new path. Her funny stories, personal reflections, and spot-on tips are the perfect match for anyone who is newly single, on the romantic circuit, or trying to move past their last relationship. Simply put, this book reminds us all that it's okay to not be okay, and is designed to help you stop wishing your life away. After listening to Unfiltered, you will have new tools to help you, and be inspired to create more love and joy in the world. I wish you the best of luck on your journey. Sending you all so much love, and enjoy this wonderful book. Kelly. Introduction. IRL, in real life. While I was writing this book, whenever anyone asked me what I did for a living, I skipped past my journalism career and simply said, I'm writing a book called Unfiltered, How to Be as Happy as You Look on Social Media. I loved seeing people nodding and laughing because they got it. I had always wanted to write about something that people could relate to, and create something that would help them help themselves. And I loved answering the questions that typically followed. What made you come up with this title? Why did you want to write about this? The truth is, this project has been on my plate for a long time, an entire decade. But it didn't start out as anything close to what it is today. Quite frankly, this book has had a life of its own and has evolved as much as I have over the past 10 years. Here is the timeline of that evolution, 2008 to 2014. Despite my career as a storyteller, I didn't have enough confidence to write a book on my own. So I asked a friend with an incredible story if I could write a book about his life. He didn't want to be that vulnerable either, but he said he would let me share his story if I put my story into the book too. We worked on the book on and off for 6 years. I flew to do interviews for his chapters of the book, and my parents even changed their vacation plans to help make one of our work sessions possible. After all that effort, he started a new job and realized he no longer wanted details about his personal life out there for the world to read. He pulled out of the project, and I didn't touch the hundreds of pages I had written for a year. 2014 to 2015. When I finally decided to do something with all that work, my dear friend Jennifer S. Wilkov was my North Star. She pops up throughout this book, so you can learn a ton from her too. I deleted everything I had about my friend's life and tried to make sense of the stories I had written about mine. Jennifer pushed me to figure out my why, the reason I was writing the book, and identify my audience. She also taught me the valuable lesson of writing for the reader. I took all her advice and worked on my book for another year. In the meantime, I happened to attend a conference hosted by Entrepreneur Media in New York City. It was there that I learned Entrepreneur publishes books in addition to Entrepreneur Magazine. I had just started my YouTube channel and thought it would be amazing if I could write a book for aspiring entrepreneurs. As you will learn, starting my YouTube channel was a grueling process, which included burning cash and both ends of the candle. In looking back at the videos I recorded in the year leading up to my channel launch and the first year of the channel itself, every video had the same theme. This is what I'm going through right now, and this is how I hope it helps you. The same theme started to emerge as my writing project moved forward. I was lucky to have incredible mentees who were willing to read my work and give me feedback that year. 2016. At the same time I was working on reshaping the book, I met the love of my life and we got engaged. While my life had always been pretty public because I often shared TV news updates and charity happenings, this experience was something I wanted to protect. So when Brett proposed, we chose not to post anything on social media. For months, people asked me why I didn't share the news publicly. My answer every time was, "I know what it's like to be single because I was single for so long, and I don't want people who are still dating to go on Facebook and feel like my good news is being thrown in their faces." Bottom line, I didn't want to ruin someone's day if they were having a hard time with being single. I was happy. I felt blessed. Only Brett and I needed to know that information and share it with people who were close to us. I didn't need the world to know I had a ring on my finger, or even see the ring. Many friends appreciated my sensitivity, while others told me seeing other people's good news gave them hope. I could appreciate both perspectives. Around that time, I was working on new chapters to show Jennifer, my North Star, and decided to send her a new introduction. In a nutshell, it included the fancy bio people read about me before I go on stage to deliver a keynote, and another bio I wrote for the book that really told the story of who I was and how I got to where I am today. The idea of showing the world who you really are has always been important to me. I included the real stuff going on in my life in my speeches and YouTube videos. When I became a contributor at entrepreneur.com in 2016, I suddenly had a bigger platform to share similar stories on a larger scale. Stories of how people turned their obstacles into opportunities. A year later, the Entrepreneur Network team introduced me to the books division, and I submitted my proposal for yet another version of my book idea. 2017. Brett and I got married in July, and we learned I was pregnant in August. We were also planning a cross-country move at the time, so needless to say, we had a lot going on. I submitted my book proposal to Entrepreneur Press in September, right before we packed up my New York City apartment and said goodbye to my bi-coastal life. On our flight to Los Angeles, I kept telling Brett I no longer liked the title of my proposal, which was, at the time, Chief Empowerment Officer, How to Be the CEO of Your Life. I'm not sure if it was my gut or my pregnancy hormones steering me in a new direction, but when I signed my book deal with Entrepreneur, all I could think about was what to call the thing. I felt the empowerment title wasn't striking the right tone. I wanted something along the lines of Life is Effing Hard, How to Be as Happy as Your Social Media Feed Looks. But I couldn't imagine my parents proudly showing my book around my hometown with the F-bomb on the cover. I spent October and November flying all over the East Coast, wrapping up my speaking tour, emceeing events, and going from meeting to try to see as many people as I could before I flew back to Los Angeles for good. I wanted to share that I was 20 weeks pregnant with everyone I saw. But Brett and I were waiting for stressful test results to come back, so I kept quiet. Meanwhile, everywhere I went, people saw a smiley and bubbly version of me. During that trip, at nearly every breakfast, lunch, and dinner date I had with friends, someone always had a struggle to share. I wanted to share my own story too, but I just couldn't bring myself to do it without knowing our test results. Those conversations only convinced me more that this book should be called Life is Effing Hard. While I was in New York, I had several meetings at Entrepreneur Media to discuss the videos I was doing for Entrepreneur.com and explained I wanted to include them in this book. From the beginning, I knew I wanted this book to be interactive and incorporate my love of creating content while highlighting other people's stories. That's why, if you're reading this book on your e-reader, computer, or mobile device, you can click on links and watch the interviews in real time. If you're listening to this book, you'll always be directed on where to go to watch the video components. In meeting with the editorial team, I asked if there were any words that I should avoid, and learned people tend to stay away from articles and videos with the word CEO and go for stories that use entrepreneur or founder instead. That was eye-opening for me, because my entire brand was Chief Empowerment Officer, and being the CEO of your life was the central concept of my book. So we went back to the drawing board for the title. I compiled my thoughts in a long email for Entrepreneur's editorial director, Jennifer Dorsey, and Vanessa Campos, the director of marketing and sales. I shared how my t-shirt line had a shirt that said, #unfiltered, because I loved the idea that we didn't need filters on our phones to make ourselves look better, and I loved the idea of people being themselves. I explained my thoughts around the title and what I wanted this book to achieve, and Unfiltered, How to Be as Happy as Your Social Media Feed Looks, was the winner. We later tweaked the title a bit for marketing reasons, but that's how this book came to be. And honestly, it perfectly captures the message I hope you get when you listen to it. That you can take some steps to live a more authentic and not necessarily picture-perfect life. What to expect? So what should you know before diving into these chapters? For starters, I broke down this book into different sections because you may need something different from the other people reading this book with you in your book club. While this book isn't meant to be all things to all people, No book can do that. It is meant to meet you where you are in life. For example, you may be listening to this book with your teenage kids and be excited about the business topics, while they're interested in the sections that deal with rejection or finding a mentor. You may be happily married, but hate going to work. Or you may love going to work and wishing one day to be happily married. You may be on a break from dating so you can invest all your energy into your new business or have more me time. You may be dealing with a bully or a toxic boss and not sure what to do. You may be facing friendship challenges and trying to figure out whom you can count on. You may be in a ton of pain and navigating how you're going to cope. Or you may be feeling motivated to amplify your activism or recovering from donor fatigue. Whatever you're going through, you may find you want to emphasize every word in some sections and skip others completely. Or you may be none of these and just wanted something to listen to on the plane. I get that too. No matter where you are in life, my hope is that you find something here that resonates. I wrote this book because we're all a work in progress, and we need different things at different times. To that end, I've included various touch points throughout this book, because no one wants to listen to block after block of dense text only to find that they missed a really great point that is meaningful to them. As you listen to this book, you'll find some chapters have tips. Those are there to provide easily accessible advice if and when you need it. The sidebars feature inspiring people or cool resources that you may enjoy or find useful. There are many exercises you can do throughout this book, from fill-in-the-blank questions to quizzes. It's up to you to do them or not. No one is judging you. If they help, that's awesome. If they're not your thing, consider at least listening through them so you can give some thought to the questions. You will also hear sections labeled hashtag my story throughout the book. If you like to feel you're not the only one going through something, then I hope you have fun listening to some of my ups and downs. If you'd rather just focus on the exercises, skip the hashtag my story sections. If you choose to listen to my anecdotes, some of my struggles may seem small in comparison to yours. Some may make you feel better about your own situation. I don't want you going through these chapters comparing your life to mine. Chances are you're already doing that with people in your own circle, especially on social media. Since success doesn't happen in a certain order, I've structured these chapters so you can jump around. If you just got rejected, you may want to start with chapters 5 and 6. If you are miserable in your job and know it's time to turn your side hustle into a career, go to chapter 9. If you are fed up with the dating scene and need a laugh, I'd suggest listening to the bad dates others and I have suffered through in chapter 13. Think of this book as a choose-your-own-adventure. What I ultimately hope you get from listening to Unfiltered is confirmation that your life is yours and that you can take steps to live beyond the veneer we present to others, both on social media and IRL. This book is not about empowering those people who make you feel less than. It's about taking your power back and investing your effort, energy, and happiness into the time you have on this planet. That's why I hope you check out the videos whenever you hear the cue, watch it. Those interviews may inspire you to take action. Disclaimer: while all of these stories are true, some names have been changed to protect people's privacy. I'm not a medical or health professional. I'm not a licensed social worker or therapist. I will not be able to relate to everything you're going through because I'm not you and I'm not living your life. I'm not a genie, nor do I have a crystal ball, so I can't promise you will finish this book with the ability to solve all your problems. I haven't started a company like Uber or Netflix, so I won't be using fancy business jargon that even I don't understand. I will share my ideas and opinions on a variety of topics. I'm going to be honest about what I have experienced and share what helped me through each messy phase to help you get through yours faster. I've also included stories from experts and extraordinary people I've interviewed who share how they managed to keep it together when nothing seemed to go according to plan. You can hear their advice, and in some cases, as I mentioned earlier, watch videos from my YouTube channel and entrepreneur.com. Lastly, I'm not being paid by anyone or any product I have mentioned or endorsed in this book, unless otherwise noted. Given how much time people spend on social media, I want to make sure you're equipped with the tools you need to live a life you love online and off. I wrote this book to help you be happy with where you are and what you have, especially when it seems everyone has it so much better than you do. I hope this book reminds you that you're okay wherever you are in life. Finally, my wish for you is that you enjoy listening to this book as much as I have loved writing it. Part 1. Know Yourself, E. Chapter 1. When Psychology Meets Technology. After a long day at work, all you want to do is catch up on your shows and have a glass of wine. You take out a glass, open Instagram, and see your friend's pictures from her most amazing day body surfing in Hawaii. Closing the app, you pull up LinkedIn to finally start your dreaded job search. Your shows will have to wait. And so will the Moscato. Hashtag FML. Maybe this has happened to you. You wake up in a perfectly good mood and grab your phone. You're curious to see what's happening around the world or what's happening in your world. Maybe you're just anxious to see how many likes your last post got since you went to sleep. Then, all of a sudden, you see it. Your friends were at a party, but no one invited you. Your colleague got your promotion. Your ex got engaged. Your younger brother just bought a house, and you're stuck in a studio. Your sister's kid started walking, and yours is barely rolling over. Whatever it is, it hits you right in the gut. Something has now downsized your day into a reason to be unhappy. If this has never happened to you, that's impressive. Either you're enjoying the lane you're in, or you're just not on any form of social media. However, for most people, this feeling of compare and despair is all too familiar. Then there's this scenario. You're having the worst day. Maybe you've hit a major bump with your significant other and someone on your team dropped the ball on a major deadline. Maybe that person was you. But instead of writing, having the worst day on your feed, you snap a picture of your avocado toast or new handbag or car, pick a fancy filter, and post, I love my life. Hashtag killing it. You do this so no one needs to know how much your life really sucks. Then, to help you forget about your crappy day, you spend the rest of it checking your phone to see how many people reacted to or commented on your post. Even though most of the people in your network are people you barely talk to, care about, or even know, you're now glued to your feed as though you were waiting for election results to tally. Before you know it, it's midnight, and you still have to do your laundry. Finally, there's this scenario, which I hear all the time. You just had lunch with a friend who spent the entire meal telling you about everything going wrong in their life, from work to love and everything in between. You listened, maybe even gave some advice, and went your separate ways. Then 2 hours later, that friend posts something that makes it look like everything in their life is amazing. And suddenly, you start to question why you can't afford those shoes or go to that awesome gym or live in that fabulous apartment. You suddenly feel like your life is less amazing. But you know the truth. You just listened to it over fish tacos for 2 hours. So how on earth does your brain distort fiction from fact? It's crazy how we are smart, capable human beings, And yet social media can send us into a tizzy. For real, it's bananas. Think it's bad if you're an adult? I feel worse for today's kids. I learned from the experts I interviewed for this book that our prefrontal cortex, our brain's controller, doesn't fully develop until age 25 or 26. So if you think you feel shitty because you weren't invited to someone's wedding or 40th birthday party, it's even harder for a kid to process being left out when everyone else shows up at school on Monday morning wearing the latest bar or bat mitzvah or sweet 16 swag. So how do you care less about what everyone else is doing and more about what's good in your life? You may think the easy answer is to not go online or avoid downloading any apps that will depress or distract you. But that doesn't always work. Some schools, companies, and even wedding ceremonies are going tech-free, which is awesome. Some of the designers behind our devices are working on more features to help us monitor our own usage. But that doesn't explain why we, the people who go to school, hold down jobs, run our homes, and raise families, get so thrown off base when we see someone else's filtered life online. So what can we do about that? We start with science. The link between our brains and social media. Social media has become the 21st century escape from our everyday lives. Whether it's to cure boredom when standing in the checkout line, or seek a sense of belonging when no one is talking to us at a party and we want to give the impression that we're cool and connected. How many times have you been home alone and, without realizing it, reached for your phone and scrolled for what seemed like seconds, but really turned into an hour? On the other hand, by plugging into our social networks, we can make meaningful connections. We can find long-lost friends, reconnect with relatives, discover community groups, or find jobs and love. We can even track down an ex or a high school crush. Our feeds enable us to remember people's birthdays and learn new things from the articles our friends post. We can listen in on people's conversations and debates without having to participate. With one click, we can promote our businesses or donate to a cause. We can drum up support for school walkouts, marches, and rallies from our kitchen table and reach people all over the world. Our social networks are great for content sharing, too. Whether it's details for a local charity drive or suggesting tourist attractions for a friend heading to Greece, we can share a lot of useful information. Studies have shown people who are battling an illness benefit from the support they receive through social media, too. If you've ever had a friend send you the perfect inspirational quote, funny meme, or viral video when you're having a bad day, you know how quickly that can raise your spirits or LOL, laugh out loud. So no, social media isn't the enemy. Loneliness is. Did you know? According to the Harvard Business Review's March 19, 2018 article, America's Loneliest Workers, According to Research, by Sean Acor, Gabriella Rosen-Kellerman, Andrew Reese, and Alexei Robichaud, research shows that loneliness has the same effect as 15 cigarettes a day in terms of healthcare outcomes and healthcare costs. The article also highlighted that lonely employees often don't perform as well and are more likely to quit. In his books and research, Sean Acor shares how simple gestures such as peer-based praise and eating lunch with a coworker can provide positive social support and improve a company's culture. In the New York Times article, UK appoints a minister for loneliness, January 17, 2018, Jaylon Yaginsu cites a 2017 report by the Joe Cox Commission on Loneliness, which found more than 9 million people in the country often or always feel lonely. In addition to being fascinated by the fact that the UK appointed an official to tackle this issue, I was saddened to read government research found about 200,000 older people in Britain had not had a conversation with a friend or relative in more than a month. Oh no, It's FOMO. While it's evident we need meaningful connections in our lives, many people who log on to social media seeking a sense of community and belonging only find superficial support. No matter how much weight we put on the number of followers, subscribers, or likes we get, that doesn't mean all those people would come to our birthday party or be there for us in the middle of the night. One way to achieve happiness is to invest your time in the people who would drop anything to FaceTime with you or actually show up at your front door when the shit hits the fan. We know we don't have to check our phones every 5 minutes, and that life will go on if we don't post something. So it's obvious social media isn't causing our pain points. But more times than not, being online doesn't help them either. "I can't go on social media anymore," is something I hear every week from men and women of all ages. When people tell me they're deleting an app from their phone, it usually lasts a day before the need to check what they're missing kicks into high gear. Thank you, FOMO, fear of missing out. In a study called "Out of Sight is Not Out of Mind," the impact of restricting wireless mobile device use on anxiety levels among low, moderate, and high users, Nancy Cheever and her colleagues found when you take away someone's phone, they reported feeling anxious, and that anxiety continued until they got their phone back. One of the people behind that study is Larry Rosen, professor emeritus and past chair of the psychology department at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Rosen has been studying the psychology of technology for more than 30 years. In our interview for this book, he told me about research he and his colleagues conducted in 2016. They studied more than 200 students to see how they used their phones. The students used an app called Instant, which tallied how many times they unlocked their phone each day and tracked how long the device remained unlocked. The study revealed students unlocked their phones 56 times a day for a total of 220 minutes. That means the students checked their phones about every 15 minutes for just shy of 4 minutes, Rosen explains. In 2017, we conducted the same study with a new equivalent group of students and found the students unlocked their phones about 50 times, but they stayed on their phones longer. This time, they spent a total of 262 minutes on their devices, which is 5.25 minutes per glance. The reason the students said they were spending more time on their phones when they unlocked them was because of social media. What he found the most fascinating was why people log on to social media in the first place. Half the time, participants said it was because they received an alert. So they unlocked their phone to see someone's post, read a new comment, or check a text. The other half of the time, there wasn't an update or alert, which means they had a slow accumulation of chemicals, such as cortisol or adrenaline, that signaled anxiety, Rosen says. Your brain starts filling in with chemicals, saying, "Someone may have posted, you should check in." And when that reaches a critical level, people act on it and go back to their phones. The fear of missing out causes so many health issues that Rosen wrote an entire book about it, Eye Disorder: Understanding Our Obsession with Technology and Overcoming Its Hold on Us. He defines this disorder as the negative psychological impact of the use of technology, which can manifest as stress, anxiety, obsessive-compulsive disorder, and depression, among other mental health issues. Simply put, FOMO has taken over our social media habits. So how did this happen? When did the very technology created to make our lives more efficient become the source of so much stress and distraction? It happened gradually over time and is only accelerating. According to Rosen, before the internet, the way technology influenced our lives came in the form of physical products, like radio, telephones, and TV. But to fully understand the rate at which technology penetrates our world today, Rosen points out that it took radio 38 years to reach 50 million users. Want to guess how long it took Pokemon Go to do the same thing? If you guessed 1 week, you are right. Four ways to back yourself out of the need to check in. If you think you are too attached to your digital device, if your phone goes where you go, whether it's to breakfast, the bathroom, the boardroom, or bed, and you want to rewire your brain, Rosen suggests trying the following. 1. Move all your social icons from your first page into a folder, so you have to make an effort to find them. 2. Check your apps on a schedule, not on a whim. Let everyone know you're doing it so they don't get pissed off when you take too long to like one of their posts. 3. Pay attention to which apps are open in the background, because we tend to check them unconsciously. If you're not scheduled to check an app, make sure that tab is closed or the app is in its folder. 4. Turn off all your alerts. You don't need to know every time someone posts something to your feed. It can wait. It may seem silly to follow these steps, because it may feel like your social media is controlling you and not the other way around. However, Rosen says measures like these are often necessary because social comparison is a very real thing that's hurting a lot of people. Why do we even care about other people so much? If someone close to you is living the perfect life, it's understandable how that could bring you down a notch. But many people find themselves getting upset when they see posts from someone they rarely talk to. Why? Rosen says this can be best explained by the social comparison theory. He says, the social comparison theory says as social animals, we compare our status with the status of other animals. We tend to forget that people only post the ideal version of themselves and only positive things, not every second of their lives. Rarely do we see negative posts. Even when we see people close to us online, we take what we see as real life. Rosen says even when we have lunch with someone and that person spills what's going on at home and it's not all good, we still believe they have a better life than we do when they post something amazing an hour later. That's just nuts. Human beings have managed to build everything from smartphones to space shuttles. How is it possible that someone could tell you to your face that business isn't going well or their relationship is on the rocks, and yet you still take their social media post at face value? It's a practice that Aviva Goldstein says is called selectively positive, and our strong reaction to this behavior is tied to our emotions. How we absorb selectively positive information. Goldstein is an educator and family counselor who focuses on positive psychology. Her projects range from curriculum and app development to individual and large-scale interventions. She says people present selectively positive versions of themselves online, not to be intentionally inauthentic, but because that's the cultural norm of how we present ourselves to the world around us. When you bump into a friend on the street and they ask how you're doing, the typical response is a positive one, like, great, doing well, all good, she says. If it's a particularly close friend, we might be inclined to peel back a few layers and say, well, you're catching me on a rough day. I have this awful cold I can't get rid of. The kids all had lice, and work has been tough lately. But that's not the narrative we usually start out with. On social media, we have the same inclinations to present a positive narrative as we would with the friend on the street. The challenge is that one passing conversation in the supermarket with an old neighbor is not the same as being bombarded by hundreds or thousands of images all day, every day, that tell a very superficial story about how everyone's day is going. Goldstein adds that on the other end of the spectrum are those friends and acquaintances who do indeed share the bumpier moments of their lives. But it's part of a cynical impulse to share everything. We probably all know people online who tell us what time they woke up, what they ate for breakfast, where they are sitting in traffic, and what's for dinner, she says. And very often, those announcements are joined by selfies of their just-woke-up face and their taco night. The goal is to find a way to allow the instinct to present a best-foot-forward approach while still being authentic. It all makes sense, but social media can still get the best of us, even those of us who know much of what we see is all smoke and mirrors. While we are aware of the intentional curation being presented online, many still engage in social comparison, consciously or not, because it's really hard to process rationally, intellectually, or cognitively when we are reacting emotionally, Goldstein says. Even if we know that we're only seeing part of the story, it's still hard to resist the envy, jealousy, or self-doubt when we literally see with our own eyes other people's successes. Goldstein says the quick and dirty solution is to block friends whose posts contribute to your own self-doubt. But it's a temporary solution and doesn't get to the root of the problem. The bigger challenge, and the one that will yield long-term resolution of depth and breadth, is getting to a place where you are so okay with where you are in life that other people's experiences don't drive you to question your own worth. Listening to this book is a huge step in that direction, she adds. Goldstein also says our constant need to compare ourselves to others within our social networks is more harmful than helpful, not only because we are consuming unrealistic versions of other people's lives, which inevitably leads us to question our own experiences, but also because it has serious health implications. Is your connection to your technology making you sick? Scientists aren't yet willing to declare that social media is addictive, but Goldstein says we do know that typical online behavior closely resembles the behavior seen with other addictions. There are addictive properties of social media. For example, the dopamine neurotransmitter, which is a chemical in the brain that controls and regulates memory, mood, behavior, and emotion, is released when refreshing a page, seeing a like, or other response. The part of the brain that lights up when a heroin addict gets their fix is the same part of the brain that lights up when receiving positive feedback on social media, she says. While many turn to social media as a way to curb boredom, it actually limits our opportunities to engage with people around us, enjoy the great outdoors, and be more present wherever we are. But as we already know, in addition to influencing our psyche, research shows the amount of time we spend online also affects our physiology. So when your eyes hurt, your thumb is sore, or your back aches, Goldstein says you may want to cut down your screen time and go to the doctor. Why do we keep going back for more? On top of feeling anxious that we're missing out on something important, think of your phone beeping or buzzing with alerts every few minutes. Goldstein says many people are attached to their devices because they crave the validation social media provides. Social validation is crucial in adolescent development and remains important for many adults, she says. Seeking social validation is actually a great ingredient in becoming functional members of society. It's how we learn normative behaviors, how to engage socially, and the nuance of drawing distinctions between different behaviors that are appropriate for different contexts. How we behave when we're eating pizza with friends is not how most of us would behave at a funeral. Social media provides easy access to validation with likes, emojis, etc. While this isn't all bad, it's not necessarily authentic validation and can distort reality. We can think that we are engaged in real friendship, when in reality, we have only shared the superficial. You might consider someone a close friend, when in reality, they've never seen you in pain or hysterically laughing or freaking out about something. So we can easily misconstrue our understanding and definitions of friendships and supportive community. Another issue with being too dependent on one's online social circle is the online disinhibition effect, which Goldstein describes as people being comfortable posting something hurtful or offensive that they would not say to someone's face, since they don't have to see the emotional pain they're inflicting. This behavior often leads to cyberbullying, which frequently spills over into real life, she says. On the flip side, we also miss out on seeing the smile we can bring to someone's face when we only engage screen to screen instead of face to face. To help you curtail your screen time and reconnect with the real world around you, Goldstein offers the following tips. Commit to speaking on the phone twice a day. Make a point of noticing the eye color of someone you spend time with. Ensure that you establish eye contact when you are together. Create a no-phone zone, either a time, dinner, before bed, etc., or a place, kitchen, table, bed, or bathroom, and stick to it. Goldstein says these habits are important because they propel us out of our routines and remind us to establish human connections with others and ourselves. She adds that the next time you log on, strive for a more meaningful experience by trying out these suggestions. Commit to engaging online with 3 people every day by commenting or messaging. Likes don't count. Commit to 1 positive, complimentary comment on someone's post every day. Commit to publicly sharing certain challenges and setbacks. Goldstein says these steps will not only make you a less passive consumer of other people's narratives, but they will also turn you into an active participant in a shared social connection and encourage others, even subconsciously, to connect in real ways with real people. Now that you have some tips you can use to help you have a more positive experience online, let's dive into some of the other areas of your life that may need some attention. Chapter 2. Name it to tame it. Identify your pain points. It's late on a Friday night, and you're stuck in the office cleaning up your boss's mistake on a project for the 5th week in a row. You look at your phone on the way to the printer and see your brother's post. On my way to Miami for the weekend. Who's around to meet up? You comment. Have the best time, Frank. Love you. Smiley face. And you wonder if you'd be a horrible person if you unfriended your sibling. Hashtag TGIF. When you're busy doing meaningful work and spending time with loved ones, you genuinely don't have time to feel woe is me when you see someone else's status. When you're at peace with your life, you also don't get as irritated when other people tell you what you should want, as in, you're 25, don't you think it's time you found a girlfriend? Or, you've been together for 3 years, shouldn't you be engaged by now? When you're busy being grateful for what you have, it's tougher for all the noise to get you down. But let's be clear. You're absolutely allowed to look at someone else's success and be annoyed your promotion is taking so long, frustrated your house still has not sold, or envious your sister just posted a picture of a sonogram when your wife is about to go through another round of IVF. Basically, you have every right to be a human being with real feelings. You are not a walking hard drive that's been programmed to be immune to the world around you. Acknowledging your feelings and understanding where they're coming from is healthy. Evaluating what you can do with those feelings to improve your situation is what inspired this book. But it's easy to follow someone's social media persona down a black hole. Since all that does is waste time, I want to start with getting to the bottom of what's really eating at you. To do that, I want you to identify your pain points. After all, you're not really going to unfriend your brother because he's going away for the weekend, again. You know deep down that you don't begrudge him or his vacation. You just loathe your job. However, knowing you're in the wrong place is only half the equation. Figuring out what you really want to do with your life, finding a new opportunity that's in alignment with your career goals, and getting that job is the other half. What we're going to do in this chapter is put your career, relationships, and contributions to society under a microscope to discover the root of your rut. My hope is that there will be some obvious things that you can change, as well as some challenges you may have been ignoring or not even realized were there. Career. There are a lot of factors that go into picking a job and staying there. Sometimes we take an opportunity solely out of necessity. Other times, we may be lucky enough to accept an offer we actually wanted. My friend Tracy Felter, who works in human resources, once said, "It's normal not to love everything about your job every day. That's why it's called a job, not a vacation." While that's true, if you dread going to work every day, you need to ask yourself, why? Is it because of where you work or what you're doing? Or both? Let's take some time to uncover what's causing your rut when it comes to your career path. Think about it and fill out the career choice worksheet. If the questions in the career choice worksheet are really what you need to be spending time on, go to chapters 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 to learn more about how to take back your happiness. Relationships. Maybe you're not really jealous your brother is on a plane to Miami for a weekend getaway. You're just freaking out that he left town when he knows you and your significant other just broke up, for good this time. You wonder who you're going to call now, and suddenly you start to panic, think you've made a mistake, and keep your phone close by in case your ex decides to text you. Anyone who has been through a breakup will tell you it's not easy. If you're the one who initiated it, you may feel bad you've hurt someone. If you're the person who just had their heart broken, you may be in shock or in pain. Relationships, whether they're romantic or platonic, can bring so much happiness into our lives. But the wrong relationships can cause damage too. Sometimes we outgrow a relationship, and other times we may find ourselves having been deceived. If you feel your relationships are the root of your rut, let's look at which relationship is the culprit. If you know which relationships are making you unhappy, take out a pen and list them during the relationship activity that follows. If you are attracting the same kind of partners, take a second to look at yourself. Where are you? What do you want? It is okay to want to be single for a while. It is okay to want to be in a serious relationship. It is okay to want to focus on schoolwork or your career. Whatever you want is fine. You are the expert on all things you. Career Choice Worksheet. Ask yourself, am I not sure what I want to do? Am I at a loss for how to use today's technology to help me find a new job? Did I just miss out on a job or promotion? Did I just get laid off or fired? Am I upset about a mistake I made at school or at work? Did my dream school just defer or reject me? Am I realizing I'm pursuing the wrong major or industry? Am I facing a setback that is keeping me from reaching my goals? Am I stuck in an environment or job I've outgrown? Do I have a toxic boss or colleagues? Do I feel uncomfortable or unsafe in my workplace? Now, fill in the blanks. I wish I had the courage to quit, speak up, get help, etc. In order for me to do this, I need to find a mentor, go to HR, update my LinkedIn profile, etc. Right now, what I feel is holding me back is fear of retaliation, losing my job, disappointing my family, etc. I would feel better about making a change if I felt safe and protected, I had another job, etc. Relationship worksheet. Ask yourself, am I in a healthy group of friends who support my goals? Am I having a hard time making friends in a new environment, school, job, or community? Am I having a hard time managing family or friends and a job? Am I having a hard time managing family or friends, a job, and a romantic relationship? Am I the only person in my group of friends who hates going to work? Am I the only person in my group who is in a relationship? Am I the only person in my group who is single? Am I new to dating? Am I stuck on an ex? Am I currently in the wrong relationship? Am I too busy to date because of school, work, or other obligations? Am I dating like a machine but repeating unhealthy patterns? Now fill in the blanks. I am happiest when I am alone, with my group of friends, with my family, in a romantic relationship. The relationship I value the most is the relationship I have with. When I am around this person or these people, I feel. It is important to me that when I am in a group of friends, I feel. It is important to me when I am in a romantic relationship that I can share my with someone who is worthy. It is important to me when I am in a romantic relationship that I feel. When I think about being around family or friends or in a romantic relationship, I am embarrassed to admit that I. Your legacy. Maybe your brother is off to Miami for the weekend, not only to escape the winter, but also to help out a friend in need. We all have the power to make someone's life better, whether it's a close friend or a stranger. The way we choose to pay it forward can be on a very micro level or a macro one. If you feel your life is lacking meaning, or you can't read or watch the news because today's headlines make you feel helpless, not hopeful, I want you to know you have something to offer. If you are going through a hard time in your personal life, you may find strength in getting involved in your community. With the help of the causes worksheet, try to pinpoint what causes are important to you and what may be holding you back from taking action. We all have so much noise in our lives that it can sometimes be hard to hear our own thoughts. I want you to go through this exercise to pause in your busy life and see what your pain points are. This was very helpful for me when I hit my own rock bottom, and it took me time to learn that negative emotions can be the most powerful catalyst to make a change. Causes worksheet. Ask yourself, am I trying to figure out what my passion is? Do I know what I'm passionate about, but don't know how to take the first step? Am I passionate about a certain cause, but facing challenges and not seeing any change take shape? Am I burned out from volunteering? Am I having a hard time getting others to care about my mission and vision? Am I involved in an organization with toxic leadership? Am I afraid of being in the spotlight? Am I convinced I don't have anything to offer a cause? Am I unsure of what it means to join a board? Am I unsure of how to plan an event? Now fill in the blank. Given my experience with... The one issue that keeps me up at night or breaks my heart is... Given the state of the world, one issue that keeps me up at night or breaks my heart is... The reason I haven't done anything more proactive until now is... I would do more at this point, but... If I... I would... File a complaint. You've identified your pain points, but you may still feel you want someone to understand and validate that what you're going through is hard. So let's agree that everyone is facing their own battle. If you are stuck in a rut, that is hard. If you are in debt, that is hard. If you have money, that is hard. If you know what you want to be doing but aren't there yet, that is hard. If you love your job.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.